Hello everyone, welcome back to Apocalypse. This is Matt and I've got some more interesting information to share with you all today. This video was originally going to be an explanation of both the Axis Mundi combined with a speculative timeline of events that led up to the creation, then subsequent destruction of Atlantis, that would have then been followed up by a potential cultural revival 7,000 years later. I've decided to split this subject into two videos. The timeline will now be explained in the next episode, as I think there is just way too much information to present. This video in particular gets pretty heavy on the math, but don't worry if you haven't brushed up on your fractions, as I will be doing all of the hard work. Hopefully this video will make it fairly easy to digest. Okay, let's get started. So just to refresh your memory from the last episode, I briefly explained how various researchers have pointed out that Avebury sits at a latitude precisely 4/7 of the way between the equator and the North Pole. I then went on to show that my proposed location for the lost city of Atlantis in the Azores sat tangentially to the latitude of 3/7 of the way between the equator and the North Pole. This begs the question. Is there anything else that we can find in the Atlantic at a latitude of 2/7 of the way from the equator to the North Pole? Let's take a look. At this latitude, we find that there are only two places in the Atlantic that are still above water today. Great Harbour Cay and Bimini, famous for its underwater megalithic road, or wall. What's fascinating about Bimini and Great Harbour Cay is that until relatively recently, they were both part of the same submerged island in the region that is now occupied by the Bahamas. This wasn't a small island either. It was over 600 kilometers in length at its longest dimensions, with a surface area comparable to Ireland. Although this picture shows the former island, now referred to as the Great Bahama Bank, during the last glacial maximum, the waters in this region are so shallow that the vast majority of this sunken island was likely still above water for the first few thousand years of the Holocene, after the Ice Age ended. This is not under debate and absolutely fits in with the standard model of global sea level rise. With regards to Bimini's megalithic underwater road or wall, it's difficult to say if this is natural or man-made. I will delve into this subject in more detail in the upcoming timeline video. For now, what I will say is that some of the methods used to date the Bimini Road come up with some very interesting numbers. So why are the latitudes of sevenths so important? To understand this, we first need to understand pi and how ancient peoples perceived this number. Well, today we define pi as the ratio of a circle's circumference to its diameter. This mathematical constant is equal to 3.14159, at least to 5 decimal places. You see, pi carries on forever, to an infinite number of decimal places, making it an irrational number, meaning that it cannot be expressed as the ratio of two integers, or whole numbers, otherwise known as a fraction. Although, we do sometimes approximate pi to 22/7, so that we can use it as a fraction. It's good enough for most applications, having an error of just plus 0.04% of pi's true value. It also looks as if the ancient Egyptians and likely other civilizations that predated them also approximated pi to 22/7. One example can be found in the dimensions of the Great Pyramid at Giza. There are many who believe that the Great Pyramid is a 43,200:1 scale model of the Northern Hemisphere, only with a square base instead of a circular base. The square base will become important in just a few minutes. The height of the Great Pyramid can be measured at exactly 280 Royal Egyptian cubits, which would be the scale equivalent to the radius of the Earth. As we know that the radius of a circle is exactly half of its diameter, we can use the equation 2 pi r to calculate the perimeter of the Great Pyramid. We will be using 280 Royal Egyptian cubits for the value of r, and we will be substituting 22/7 for pi. When we complete the equation, we find that the Great Pyramid should have a theoretical perimeter of 1760 Royal Egyptian cubits precisely. This integer can only be achieved by using 22/7. If we use the true value for pi, we would end up with another irrational number. Just to confirm our calculations, we can measure each side length of the pyramid very accurately to 440 Royal Egyptian cubits. If we add the length of each side together, we find that the physical dimensions match the theoretical dimensions, proving that the Great Pyramid is indeed a square-based model of a hemisphere, although it's difficult to prove if this was just an accident or done by intent. But perhaps there is a clue from another culture that can shed some light on the intentions of the ancient Egyptians. If we look at the Babylonian model of the universe, the Earth is depicted as a seven-stepped great ziggurat. Perhaps the seven steps are supposed to represent the seven latitudes used by ancient geodetists to characterize the northern hemisphere. The Babylonian model may have been a little more overt than that of the ancient Egyptians, but you'll see in just a few moments how the seven latitudes may have been secretly encoded into the Great Pyramid by choosing to give it a square base. I asked retired engineer Michel Desmarais why ancient geodetists would have chosen to split the latitudes of the northern hemisphere into seven equally spaced arcs. In reply, Michel says, "Concerning the fractions in sevenths, the expression of pi by 22 over 7 may bear strong links with our modern angular unit of radian. A full Earth great circle of 360 degrees then measures 2 pi radians, or 22 over 7 multiplied by 2, 44 over 7. Then a quarter from the pole to equator is pi over 2, or 11 over 7. This looks consistent with your locations between the North Pole and equator." Before we continue, I should probably explain exactly what a radian is. Put simply, a radian is an angular unit of measure based on the radius of a circle. One radian is the angle obtained from an arc equal in length to its radius. This equates to approximately 57.30 degrees for the true value of pi, or 57.27 degrees for 44 over 7. Therefore, we can say that there are 2 pi radians in a circle, as this gives us our total of 360 degrees. Now let's show how important this would have been to ancient geodetists, who likely didn't have the methodology necessary to work with irrational numbers. If we look at this circle representing a cross-section of the Earth, by dividing the radius into 7 equal segments, then dividing the quarter circumference into 7 equal arcs, you can find the length of each arc by multiplying a segment by 11 over 7. Let's take this a step further. We'll leave the quarter circumference alone, divided by 7. What we will do, however, is divide the radius by 280, to represent the 280 Royal Egyptian cubit height of the Great Pyramid. This is where it starts to get interesting, because what you will find now is that the length of an arc is equal to the length of a segment multiplied by 440 over 7. This is how I think the seven latitudes were encoded into the geometry of the Great Pyramid, as this would not have been possible if the pyramid was constructed with any number of sides other than 4. If this was the intention of the architect of the Great Pyramid, you'll find that it's a little more nuanced or refined than the Babylonian model of a seven-stepped ziggurat. I really don't want to go off on too much of a tangent, so I'll just briefly mention that I'm working on a separate video where I combine the principles of the seven-stepped ziggurat with the geometry of the Great Pyramid to create what I believe could be an effective navigational tool for ancient explorers. Getting back on topic, we have to ask the question, how could people in the distant past have applied all of this geometric knowledge to characterize the size of the planet? Well, what I think likely happened is that a group of ancient geodetists and explorers had chosen one of the seven latitudes as their starting point. Traveling precisely true south, using the sun at high noon to plot a course over a period of months, or possibly even a few years, they would have taken trigonometric measurements of the local terrain, much as a modern surveyor might, to determine how far south they had traveled as they slowly made their way towards the next seventh line of latitude. Once they had arrived at their final destination, possibly determined by using a tool similar to a modern sextant, they would have been able to add up the total distance they had traveled to determine exactly how far it was between the seventh lines of latitude. Once this information had been obtained, all you would need to do is multiply this distance by 7 to determine the quarter circumference of the Earth. Similarly, you could multiply the distance by 28 to determine the full circumference of the Earth. The radius of the Earth can then be determined by dividing the quarter circumference by 11 over 7. Now there's a reason why I've chosen to use Avebury as the starting point in my presentation, because I think this location has been used in the ancient past for this very purpose, and not just once either. I think this location may have been used twice to determine the size of the planet. I'm absolutely on board with the academic dates proposed for the construction of Avebury, with the earliest parts being erected at approximately 3000 BCE. But I also believe the same location may have been used in the far more distant past. I will explain my reasoning in just a moment, but I would first like to make you aware of the research of Howard Crowhurst. In his books, Crowhurst points out some very interesting geometric knowledge regarding Avebury and its surrounding complex. For the purposes of this video, I want to draw your attention to his research on the nearby Silbury Hill, because Crowhurst shows us that the very center of Silbury Hill is located 1,428.85 meters true south of the 4/7 latitude marked out by the Avebury Stone Circle. 1,428.85 meters is exactly 1,000th of the distance between each 7th line of latitude. It makes you wonder if the builders of the Avebury complex were trying to build a permanent point of reference for any future civilizations to accurately measure out the size of the planet just in case all was lost in a future cataclysm. As I said before, I completely agree with the academic dates that are assigned to the various structures found at the Avebury complex, but this doesn't mean that there wasn't something there before. Given that the latitude of Avebury was chosen to be located precisely 4/7 of the way from the equator to the North Pole, I find it difficult to believe that the longitude was chosen at random. If we wind back the clock to the last glacial maximum, circa 20,000 years ago, we can see that Avebury was the westernmost point on the 4/7 line of latitude that allowed for an expedition to take place following a true south line, all the way towards the 3/7 line of latitude that also didn't require the expedition to enter into the Atlantic Ocean. When measuring the distance between these two lines of latitude, having to cross a body of water would certainly add unwanted complexities to any measurements. So why would they want to occupy a site this far to the west? Well, I think the original founders of this location wanted it to be as close to the Atlantic Ocean as possible, both for logistics and for creating astronomical charts to aid sailors in finding their longitude anywhere in the Atlantic Ocean. I won't go into too much detail in this video, but it is a relatively easy task for an experienced navigator to work out their latitude. However, finding one's longitude is a much more difficult proposition. Before GPS, longitude could be calculated by using a marine chronometer or clock that had been synchronized with the port of origin. The time difference between various astronomical events, such as a sunrise or sunset, would allow a navigator to calculate their precise longitude. Prior to the invention of the marine chronometer, a skilled navigator could find out their approximate longitude by measuring the angular distance between the moon and a particular star, as shown in Petrus Apianus's 1524 work, Cosmographia. They could then reference the angle to a book of tables to find the predicted time at a reference point such as Greenwich, or in more ancient times, perhaps Avebury. However, this would require that navigators keep their book of tables up to date. This would also require full-time astronomers to produce these up-to-date tables. If ancient peoples were capable of what I'm proposing, would it not then make sense to have an observatory not only on the east of the Atlantic, but also on the west of the Atlantic, and possibly somewhere in the middle? Perhaps we are starting to get to the root of the original geodetic origins of important prehistoric locations. Now that we have some background information on the 2/7, 3/7 and 4/7 lines of latitude, how does this all relate to the Axis Mundi? Firstly, what do I mean by Axis Mundi? Well, an axis is just a fixed reference line for the measurement of coordinates, and Mundi is the Latin word for world. So we can say that the Axis Mundi is a global reference line for the measurement of coordinates. In modern astronomy, we might consider the Axis Mundi to represent the celestial poles about which our planet rotates. But this is not the Axis Mundi that I'm talking about today. I'm talking about the mythological Axis Mundi, the cosmic axis, the world pillar or world tree, the center of the world. This place represents a unique location that connects the surface world of mortal men to both the heavens and the underworld. This symbology ties in very well with the Atlantis theme. Atlantis may have served as a center of learning for ancient astronomers, connecting mortal men to the heavens, if you like. After the deluge, this place formerly inhabited by mortal men could now be considered as the underworld. Perhaps it is no coincidence that we picture Atlas, the king of Atlantis, holding the heavens, sometimes even the world, upon his shoulders. Perhaps there is some hidden esoteric meaning in this symbology, a feat truly worthy of a titan. So why might Atlantis represent the center of the world? Well, I think there are two reasons. Firstly, Atlantis could be considered as the birthplace or center point for civilization. But I also believe there is a second, more literal meaning. At some point in the ancient past, it's possible that a world map of sufficient detail was produced where somebody realized that all of the continents fit together like a jigsaw puzzle, just as Alfred Wegener did over 100 years ago in 1912 when he published The Origin of Continents. It just so happens that the Azores are at the very center of this landmass, Pangaea. Obviously, humans didn't exist 200 million years ago, when the continents were last in this configuration, but because it was at the center, and at the very location where Pangaea began to break apart, it might have been considered as the most geologically appropriate location to mark out the ancient prime meridian, especially as the continents, even to this day, are still heavily biased towards the Atlantic side of the planet. This symbology might even explain why so many creation stories describe the world as an egg that has cracked open. With all this in mind, I would propose that the Axis Mundi is the 3/7 line of latitude, with Atlantis representing the ancient prime meridian. At this point, I have to mention Richard Heath, specifically his book Sacred Number and The Lords of Time. I don't want to give too much away about his book, but if you're interested in this video, it's an absolute must read. In contrast to what I said earlier in this video, Heath argues that establishing geocentric latitude did not rely on equipment pointing at the sky to measure angles on the horizon. He also provides numbers, diagrams, and explanations to back this up. I'm still of the opinion that some kind of instrumentation was likely used by navigators and sailors at a minimum, even if this was not necessary at land-based observatories. Heath also goes into some detail about the significance of various latitudes, including the three I've been focusing on in this video. I think you'll get a broader picture of what's going on after reading his book. Anyway, I've digressed, because what I wanted to point out from Heath's book is that he makes mention of a Greek tale where the god Zeus sends eagles from either edge of the world to find the center, or Omphalos, at Delphi in Greece. Heath argues that the 2/7 and 4/7 latitudes represent either edge, as Delphi sits in the middle, less than 10 kilometers south from the 3/7 line of latitude. It should be noted, as mentioned by Hugh Newman in his Delphi video, that there might be evidence for an earlier site further up the hill from Delphi, which, if you look at the local terrain, would make this earlier site further north, or closer to the 3/7 line of latitude. As I mentioned a few moments ago, Omphalos means center, or more accurately, navel. Delphi was marked out by the sacred Omphalos stone as it was considered to be the center of the earth. Allegedly, this stone was placed by the god Zeus where the two eagles crossed paths. I think it's possible that sites of geodetic significance were chosen and settled during the Pleistocene to help ancient astronomers and geodeters with their tasks of charting the heavens and measuring the earth. We have Bimini, or the Great Bahama Bank, at the 2/7 line of latitude, Atlantis at the 3/7 line of latitude, and Avebury at the 4/7 line of latitude. After the Ice Age ended, the site at Bimini and the site at Atlantis would have been submerged. Several thousand years later, after the Ice Age ended, it was as if all of this work from the ancient past was recreated. As Avebury was never submerged, it was still a viable location for an observatory on the 4/7 line of latitude. Delphi now replaced Atlantis as the observatory on the 3/7 line of latitude, and Bimini was replaced by Thebes in Egypt, which incidentally served as the capital city of ancient Egypt for long periods during both the Middle and New Kingdoms. The 2/7 line of latitude passes right through Karnak, which also housed its own Omphalos stone in the temple of Amon-Re. Before we end this video, I just want to spend a little more time exploring the 3/7 line of latitude, or what I'm calling the Axis Mundi. I've had a hunch that there might be a marker of some kind in the Iberian Peninsula at this latitude. I'd like to thank Targusman for sending me this comment after watching the previous episode. Targusman brings to our attention the site of Almendras Cromlech, the largest group of structured standing stones in the Iberian Peninsula, in Portugal. Just like Atlantis, this site lies a short distance south of the 3/7 line of latitude. Surely this is more than a coincidence. It even looks to be pointing to the west, towards the Atlantic. The oldest parts of this construction date back to 6000 BC, predating modern Avebury and the first dynasty of ancient Egypt by nearly 3000 years. Just as a side note, as to why Atlantis might be offset south from the 3/7 line of latitude, we might find a clue from this Egyptian artwork, circa 1000 BC. It represents the first occasion, Zep-Tepi, at the sacred mound of creation, with the two goddesses pouring the primeval waters around the sacred mound. More importantly, the sun could be seen rising between two mountains in the east. If Atlantis sat directly over the 3/7 line of latitude, the mountain that is now Fayal Island would block the sunrise on the spring and autumn equinoxes. By placing the site a little to the south, the sun rises directly between the two mountains, otherwise known today as Fayal and Pico Island. It's interesting that there is a hieroglyph for this called the Arket, and that the very same word, Arket, in the ancient Egyptian calendar represented the season of the flood. The stones at Almendras Cromlech got me wondering, could there be a site of interest on this same latitude in the Americas? Well, there is something in northeast Kentucky that has caught my eye. If we look at this ridge complex, there happens to be something that stands out from everything else. Just a little way north of the 3/7 line of latitude, there looks to be some kind of gigantic mound. Let's be careful, because this could be a completely natural feature. The tree line certainly adds an element of pareidolia to this location. But let's just use our imaginations for a moment. Is it possible that rather than building a mound from scratch, that some people in the past carved out a section of the ridge, just leaving the tip to form a semi-natural mound? There are a few reasons why I'd like to explore this site in further detail, because it just so happens to have a very similar diameter to the central island of Atlantis. It's in a region well known for its mounds, and it is almost exactly 1 radian in distance from Almendras Cromlech. That's a lot of coincidences, but there's one more thing. It also happens to be exactly 48 kilometers from the tail of Serpent Mound. This distance is important because there just so happens to be a number of key locations in the ancient world that are separated by distances that are divisible by 4 kilometers. For anybody who doesn't believe that there is a link between the metric system and ancient systems of measurement, we can show that if you take a circle, exactly 1 meter in diameter, by dividing the circumference in 6, you have exactly 1 royal Egyptian cubit. Like I said earlier, let's not get carried away, because this mound could be completely natural, but also, please take into consideration that this mound looks like it could be on private property, so don't go running up there with pickaxes and shovels. I think this is probably a great place to end the video. I've provided some links below to some of the topics that I've presented today. The next video will be the timeline video, where I will try to attempt to piece all of this together. I will also cover the world tree aspect of the Axis Mundi that I have purposely omitted from today's video. Anyway, take care everyone, see you in the next video. Cheers.